Logically, it's a part of the industry. So a continuous cultural sequence has been obtained. Where to put the irons then? Irons cannot be put around 800 BCE. That will be too late. It may be put somewhere between 7000 BCE and 800 BCE, before Common Era, which was earlier called BCE before Christian Era. Accepted that instead of calling this Christian era, we should call it Common Era, because Christian era has a religious overtone. Just to avoid that, to make it more secular. And here, very interesting, some of the anthropologists like Hemphill, Lucas and Kennedy have shown that there are only two black or two new introductions in the anthropological record from 7000 BCE down to 800 BCE or so. That one black is around 4500 BCE, and second time around 800 BCE new elements arrive. So again the question arises, where to put the items? So controversy remains, problem remains. Next thing, interesting thing with the archaeologists, that the invaders, they came from outside. Having entered in the plain, they found the flourishing cities and destroyed them, and under the guidance of their warlord, the Indra. That's why Indra is often called Purandara, Purambhetta, Purbhetta, destroyer of foes. So it is very easy to relate under these two things. That's what Abhay Vigar said. But his predecessor, the first Director General of the Archaeological Survey of India, Sir John Marshall, while writing a report on Mohenjo-Daro excavation, called it Indus civilization, and tracing it back to the pre-Vedic times. But Vigar went a step ahead, called it, believed that he had convinced himself that invading Aryans destroyed the flourishing civilization of the Harappans. So naturally the Harappans became pre-Vedic. But the theory was critiqued by archaeologists as well as historians. Now nobody believes that Aryans were responsible for the destruction of Harappans. Then the question arises. One thing is very clear. Harappan civilization is the culmination of a long cultural process, which, as I said earlier, pointed out earlier, started from around 7000 BCE. Thereafter, there were several stages of development. The earliest stage was Neolithic stage, early farming stage, early village farming stage, when there were no pottery, no metals. But they have started growing some crops, barley, three species of wheat, two species of barley, and even cotton. Cotton is the contribution of the Indians to humanity. And some animals like sheep, goats, and cattle. But still, pottery was not known to them, nor any metals were known. The second stage comes when pottery came into picture. Third stage comes when copper comes into the picture, with some evolution, with some development, with some innovations. Calcolithic means copper age cultures. And then around 31 or 3200 BC comes proto-urban stage, and that is the stage when bronze comes into picture. We call it early bronze age. And and he has written brilliant introduction to each volume. And those introductions are worth reading. With some evidence on hand, he declared, he announced that, mind it, 70 years before the discovery of Harappan civilization, he said that Rigvedic people were city living people, they were manufacturing people, they were trading people, they were maritime people. Unfortunately, that theory was never developed. Before that, I would like to tell you a few salient things of the Harappan civilization. It is remarkable for its long life, from circa 2500 BC to 1900 BC. Some would like to add one century more to the Big Book, and a vast territory of about 7 million square kilometers. It means 7 lakh square kilometers, a long area, which covers the entire Indus Basin, almost the entire Indus Basin, and the peripheral areas, including the coastal areas of some parts of Gujarat and the Makran coast. And also going beyond the Himalayas to have it their established bank in North Afghanistan at a site called Shor Tubai. Two sites are our frontier site, trading sites or special purpose sites, Lothal on the one hand and Shor Tubai on the other hand, which were established for a special purpose by the Harappans. Because around them we don't find the Harappan typical Harappan sites. Harappans are notable, as I said, attaining a high degree of sophistication, amazing formalism in all what they created. Standardization, utilitarianism. They were very down to earth people, very practical people. And these attributes, all these attributes are well manifested in all the spheres of their activities, whether it is an exquisite town planning, monumental buildings, impressive architecture, water structures, and the impression of the seas, what we call in our cultural parlance, ceilings, seal impressions. That means escaped. Harappans, I mean, they created a very, very fine script, although it still remains a closed book, undeciphered so far. And a wide range of weights and measures. And that sophistication, that classicism is reflected in their pottery or all forms of arts, whether Gothic art, terracotta art, drawings, stone, etc. Jewelry, in their jewelry, whether of gold or copper or silver, copper or all those things, or silver precious stones, and their implements, all metal implements, implements of stone or shell. In addition to above, the Harappans had extended the trade to far off countries. Mesopotamia is one country with which we had a very brisk trade. And the Harappan material has been found in different parts of Iran, in Central Asia, particularly Turkmenistan, and some amount of things have been found in Oman and UAE. Though UAE and Oman have not given any urban civilization, any form of urban civilization, but it is extremely rich in certain things like copper. The central ridge is full of copper because both the areas have no metallic ore to extract copper from that. Next, please. This gives a long cultural sequence before the Harappans. Next, please. And I've also talked about this also. Next, please. The main argument in favor of now the question arises whether Harappans could be Aryans or not. The main argument in favor of non-Aryan character of the Harappans lies in the concept of the rural urban dichotomy that that is believed to exist between the two, that is Vedic on one side, Harappan. Vedic was supposed to be nomadic people, pastoralists, who came with their cattle flocks in chariots from the northwestern passes into the Indus plain. Though we know that how difficult it is to see the geographical terrain of the northwest, how chariots drawn by horses can come. There are no roads, nothing. The terrain is very, very difficult for all those things. But that was the idea. When this theory was very badly critiqued, then the historians started saying that they migrated. Not invaded, but they migrated. Then they said migrated in batches. So, different stages of their thought. Whereas, on the other hand, the Vedic Aryans were generally depicted as far less civilized, or rather barbarian equestrians who roamed about in Central Asia, the Iranian plateau, and even beyond, before entering the Indus plain. And on entering here, they defeated many existing communities called by different names, ethnic names, community names such as Dasa, Dasyus, Padi, Asuras, and so on. There are other names also. Next, please. I have told you about H.S. Wilson's embryonic theory. And then the next, please. And now, a detailed study of the Rig Veda tells us a lot about their geography, their settlements, nature and hierarchy of the settlements, structures, their nature and hierarchy, water structures, mercantile activities, maritime activities, ships and shipping, land routes and means of transport. There are a number of gaps even engaged in, because it will take the whole day. So I will just give you salient things like geography. A nice verse is there in the Rig Veda, Yasya me himanto mahitva, Yasya samundam rasya sahav. They are talking about right from the Himalayas to the seashore, to the sea. So obviously, the land of seven rivers between the Himalayas and the sea. That was the terra firma of the Rig Vedic people. And interestingly, this is the area which is the terra firma of the Harappan civilization also. All Harappan sites, whether major, minor or this, are between the Himalayas on the one hand, sea on the other side. No other archaeological culture before the Harappans, nor any other archaeological culture after the Harappans, ever occupied this entire area ubiquitously. Harappan civilization, Harappan sites, Harappan territory is the only site which is distributed all over that area. Any other archaeological culture after the Harappans ever occupied this entire area ubiquitously. Harappan civilization, Harappan sites, Harappan territory is the only site which is distributed all over that area, which was so familiar, which was so often referred to by the Rig Vedic people. So obviously the Harappas remain the sole, and of course, seven rivers. Which are the seven rivers? Five rivers of Punjab, the Indus on the west, and Saraswati in the east. And now the doubting soul have always put a mark over this Saraswati, present day Saraswati. Next, please. And now, in support of Saraswati, in the present location of Saraswati, what we call as the Saraswati, is precisely what is reflected in the Nadi Sukta of the Rig Veda. Imam me Gange Yamune Saraswati Sutudri Sasta Parishu. It was between Satluj and Yamuna. That is the precise location of the search. And it is called Saptati Sintu Mata. It is called the seventh among the Indus mothers, Sindhu Mata. Seven Sindhu Matara are there. So it is the seventh one. So there is no doubt that this immensurated Saraswati is the map showing you area. Nadi Sutta I have already referred to. This is the map, I'm already familiar. The one on the right shows you the area of the Saraswati, area of the Harappan civilization, which I say that is co-terminus with the Rigvedic geography. Next, there are very interesting terms of the settlements in the Rigveda. One of them is very oft repeated is Pura. Pura. Pura means Pri is derived from the root say Pri, which means to protect. So naturally Pura should be a protected settlement, a fortified settlement. And different qualifying adjectives are given to the Pura. And other kinds of Sadhastha, Tri Sadhastha, Chardis, Chardis. Chardis will be protected with ramparts. Again, Durga, Duryo, Durya, they are also very protected. But different from Sharman and Pura, they may be smaller in size. Chardis may be a hut bank of protected hut bank. Cattle breeders or those on the who feed sheep and goats. Present. And sometimes the brothers are also very elaborate. They have also protection all around. And sometimes they are called Saptasya, having seven mouths for access. Next please. Yeah, this is a very good example of Tridhatu Sharman, Trivaruthi Sharman. Castle and Delhi, two parts in the southern part, are the citadel, Pura. Then middle town and lower town. All of these are fortified settlements within the outer fortification. So there is a very intricate system of fortifications at Dholagiri. Here, after making an analysis of the different occurrences, different references to Pura, I found that there are in all 27 adjectives given to the Puras, out of which 15 belong to the Aryan folks, Aryan Puras, and only 11 to 12 belongs to their adversaries who they defeated. Next. So there are several such references which tell us about how strongly all forts were protected with strong fortification walls. I will leave that this portion also. They are talking about a man living in a Pura, Puri mein Janu, Janu na Puri, ek Puri mein rehne wala aadmi. And they talk about the Paur, which is a typical term, Paur Janpada, who is very familiar with the later Sanskrit. They can quickly understand what does a Paur means, what does a Janpad means. Again, I am not. Next please. Next thing. The last one is very interesting. Paur Chidab. For I did 3 times you word for. Next please. Yes. One thing which is strange, that the Aryans, Rigvedic Aryans particularly, conceived of a presiding deity for all kinds of things, whether settlements, whether Pura, whether Vrija, or whether Vijana, or whether house, whether crafts, different kinds of crafts, whether roads, whether this and that, whether sea trade and all those. Yeah, we have already talked about this. Next is Mohenjo-daro. Next, Dholagiri again. Next, different parts of Dholagiri. Fortified ones within the outer fortification. For the first time, Dholagiri has given its outer fortification. Shardipur. Shardipur has given different meanings by the Sanskritists. As autumnal refuse, or their something different. But to me, Shardipur is one, that kind of Pur is the word for possibly well-defined Pur, well-defined city. Next, please. So, Harappan settlements, whether it is small cities or even villages, have a very well-defined street system. A thoroughfare, either running from north to south or east to west, or another staggered system of streets running in the opposite direction. If the straight streets are running from north to south, then east-west will be staggered. Staggered means tortuous, like straight through one sector, then in another sector it will stagger. In third sector, it will again stagger, like this. But all are very broad, wide. Next, please. Likewise, large number of words are here. Some of them are synonymous, some of are different forms of structures. I have collected all those. Griha, Dana, Dama, Dham, Dham, Dhaman, Chaya, Okas, Vasati, Nivishan, Neer, next, Sadban, Sadan, Sadas, Sansat. These are Harimya. Haram, jise kehte hain aaj kal, Haram. Kyaro Haram reh gaye tere deewane ka. Haram is the word that goes back to the Vedic times, Harimya. Oh, Sadban is very special word. Sadman is a world's place where people are sitting together for prayers, for assembly, for something. And then how it is elaborated, I think in the next slide it will come. There are how Sadman, it becomes Shukra Sadman, a whitewashed Sadman. Prasadman, a larger assembly hall. Deer Prasadman, very large one. Or Swadu Sansada, a place where people are sitting together for taking food. So, these are the terms which tell us about the kind of architecture they had, public architecture. Next, please. And there is a beautiful verse in which in the Rig Veda, which tells us about a palace with a Pushkarani. Pushkarani Vaveshpa. Bhujasya Vidam Pushkarani Vaveshpa. A house, a Veshma, having a Pushkarani. The great bath of Mohenjo-daro, of that independent thing. Yeah, it's a palatial building, you see, having several rooms, having colonnades all around the great bath, walking space first, and then colonnade, then rooms, and series of rooms. And one of the rooms has a well for drawing water to feed the great bath. And then they provided an outlet through which the dirty water was let flow upwards, about which all of you must be very familiar. Sabha, Samiti, and Vidatha. Vidatha is not known, maybe not very much known, but Sabha or Samiti. Abhi bhi hamari samitiyan bahut hoti hain. Lok Sabha hai, Rajya Sabha hai. Sabha, a gathering or a place which has bha, abha, it is prakash. Samiti, where all people come and sit together. So these are very interesting words, Sabha and Samiti, which in later Vedic literature are called the daughters of Sabha and Samiti, are called the daughters of Prajapati. Budhnya, Prasubudhnya, Kabanda, Avant, Pushkara, Pushkarani. Pushkar, Pushkarani, I have already talked to you about. Poop you do well, it is well, of course. Avat is another very word, very nice word. Avat should be a square or rectangular water body. And Us is a spring. Usadhi means a spring which has been enclosed by a construction. The kind of knowledge we have in Uttarakhand. General Sahib might have seen some of the knowledge of Almora and all those places. Water springs are rendered pakka with steps and all that, and sometimes with a temple above. It is supposed to be very sacred. It is not to be defiled. It is meant only for taking water, not for washing hands, feet, or taking bath. It's supposed to be very sacred. That is Usadhi. Next. This is a well from Dholadira. The picture is not coming up nicely. Next is water structure. Very elaborate system of a series of cascading series of water reservoirs have been created by the Harappans all around the built up area of the Harappan city at Dholavira, and all those water structures are well within the, I think, the first example of the rock cut architecture. It is carved out by cutting the rock. Next. So we have excavated about 6-7 such water reservoirs. Many more still remain buried, waiting for exposure. I have already talked to you about the different walks of life, for each of which they conceived of a god, presiding god, which are normally goes with your trade and commerce. Earth, Abhyaya. Abhyaya means a capital, a corpus, from the interest of which you run your institutions. That is abhyaya, that is investment, corpus. Bhaga, a share. Gratha, capital. Shulka, for customer octroi tax. And Bali, tribute given to the authority or king. Savitta and Vitta, for wealth or money. Samvidana, an agreement or a contract between the two parties. Vasna, Vasna is a very important word, that is value, cost or weight. What was the weight system of the Harappans? It was based on 16. Sexer, decimal or decimal, based on 16, or even before the introduction of metric system, our all weight systems of currency were based on 16. Sola ane ka ek rupiya, sola share ka, sola chatang ka ek share. Chatang is nothing but Sodhishansha, 116th part. 116th part of a coin was called Kala. 116th part of weight system is called Sodhishansha, that is. So, this is a legacy which we got from the Harappans down to 1958 or 59 when metric system was adopted. Ab to sab decimal ho gaya hamara. तब 16 बेस था. नेक्स्ट वीक खत्म हो गया. एंड नाउ आई विल टॉक जस्ट टू थिंग्स अबाउट दी मैरिटाइम एक्टिविटीज. एज आई टोल्ड मारा, द ट्विन ब्रदर्स आर सेड टू बी द प्रिजाइडिंग ड्यूटी गॉड्स ओवर द सी स्ट्रेट. दे आर They often move in their ship, which is sometimes very, very elaborate. Sudhirgh Prasadman. They are residing Sudhirgh Prasadman. How a ship, seaworthy ship was having three masts, Tribandhura or Triskambhas, and each mast fitted with two sails. So Rigvedic people always crave of the things coming from the other shore. They are disposal of the dead of the Rigvedic people. Here, before I tell a few things about this thing, I will tell you the Harappans were a cosmopolitan people. They talk about Agni Swata, Agni Dagda, Anagni Dagda, Yekecha Patra, Pitra, Pitra Pareyu. Oh, dead ancestors, where you consent to the fire or not consent to the fire, come and accept our offering. Like that, Agnishwata, Agnidagdha, Agnishwata, Anagnidagdha, Anagnishwata. These are the main terms. And then comes Paropta. Paropta means you have a primary disposal here. Later on, after 1 year or so, you remove the skeleton, wash it, and do some ritual and bury it back in another grave in the regular cemetery. Stop it here. Thank you very much.